Let him take and guide and lead. That's what we need to do today.
That's right.
Amen.
Have you gone pray for a pastor now at this time?
Yes, right.
Come on, Brother Vern. Pray God's word.
Bless the Lord. Good Jesus.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Thank God for Brother Johnny and for the job that he does up here at the services here on Sunday morning.
Right.
How about a hand for Brother Johnny? Sunday school teacher, Brother Clinton. Melissa, the daughter, Clinton. Amen. All right, it's a good place to be this morning. She sang that song about trusting the Lord. I look out across the congregation and I see several testimonies, many, many testimonies of lives who are here right now because you did just that. You trusted the Lord.
That's right, brother.
Yeah.
I think about the doubts, Brother Gerald and Sister Vicki, how they've trusted the Lord for all these 40-plus years traveling all over this country, singing and preaching about Jesus, spreading His gospel. Yeah. Trusting the Lord to get them from place to place. And David and Cynthia and the trials that they've been through this year, and how that you've trusted the Lord and God has brought you through, and you're here today as a testimony of what God has done in your life. You're a blessing to us. I think back several years back, Brother Johnny had an accident, was out of work, no income, just totally trusting God to meet his needs, and God has met his needs, and he has his wife and these two boys in church with him this morning, and I thank God for that, trusting God. And I could go on. Brother Bob and Sister Tammy. I want to tell you about trusting the Lord. But Brother Bob had an appointment to hear to preach one Sunday morning. Asked him to preach one Sunday morning, the following Sunday morning, and from one Sunday to the next, his house burnt to the ground. And they lost everything that they had. You know, I just kind of dismissed it in my mind. As far as Brother Bob preaching, I didn't expect him to come in here and keep that preaching appointment after losing everything he had. He walked in the door just a couple of days after losing everything and said, "Is it still okay to preach here this morning?"
It
was one of the best messages that you'll ever hear.
Yeah.
We had camera trouble that morning, and unfortunately it wasn't in God's providence to get that message recorded, but it was one of the best messages I'd ever heard.
Yes.
About 2 days after losing everything he had, he was trusting the Lord. He's trusted the Lord all this time. Brother Bob and Sister Tammy, they're still trusting the Lord today. And God has worked some things out in their lives. He's taken us somewhere.
Yes.
I thank God for the promises that we have in this Bible, that if we trust God, he's going to see us through.
Yeah.
Amen.
We're going somewhere.
Amen. Amen.
Much better than this place down here.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give him some glory. And so many others. You know, we named a few names this morning. I could go on. Lots and lots of you have trusted God, and you've been blessed for so doing.
Yeah.
And I believe we ought to just keep right on trusting.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm not going to ask you to stand this morning. When we get there, I'm going to read Titus chapter 2. And it's 15 verses long. When we get to the scripture reading, I want to just read the whole chapter. It'll take us about 3 minutes to do that. But as I think this morning about our Lord and dear precious Savior, Jesus Christ, he didn't come down to this world to be some great politician, although, you know, the world probably could have used one at that time. He didn't come down to this world to be some great organizational leader, although they probably could have used one at that time. But he came as a teacher, as a rabbi, to teach people about the ways of God and to teach people about the life of living in God's kingdom. And that was crucial to his ministry here on planet Earth. And of course we know the main purpose was to seek and to save that which was lost and to do the work that the Father sent him to do. He said, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me," and he did that. He fulfilled it. To the very letter, he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And I'm very thankful this morning to know that I stand before you saved because Jesus Christ came to save sinners.
Amen.
He came to seek and to save that which was lost. He said, "I came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, to give my life a ransom.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Bless the Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. Bless the Lord.
He came, and he laid his life down willingly. They didn't take it from him. He laid it down. He went to the cross. He said, "My Father, he gave it to me to lay it down. He'll give me the power to raise it back up again." He rose again on that third appointed morning, and he's alive today at the right hand of God. He's coming back, and to those who are looking for him, shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. But he came as a teacher. He wasn't a politician. He wasn't some organizational leader. He wasn't a motivational speaker. He wasn't just some good man. How many of you believe that this morning? Oh, he was a good man. Make no question about it, but he was more than a man. He was more than a good man. He was God in the flesh. Amen. Who came and made his abode down on this planet earth and walked among men. And he said, "The birds of the air have nests and the foxes have holes, but the Son of God hath not where to lay his head." And he lived a humble life, obedient unto God, and he prayed three times in the garden, "Lord, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done." And he drank the cup. Amen. That come by, he took it, and he drank it. And because of that, each and every one of us that are in this place this morning, we have hope of an eternal life. And I'm glad to know who Jesus is this morning. He came. He taught the word of God. He was a great preacher. He was a great teacher. He was a rabbi. And you know, he was committed to the ministry. This wasn't just something that he took up in his spare time to get him out of Joseph's carpenter shop. No, this was his purpose. This was his ministry. He fulfilled it. This was what he did. He came down here to do. He was a great teacher. He was a great preacher. He spoke with authority. He spoke the word of God. They looked at him one day and said, "What manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey his voice?" We've never seen anything like him before. Amen. And that's who he was. A great teacher. You know, we need great teachers even today. I went back to my childhood when I was growing up. I had a good teacher in the sixth grade. Mr. Altizer was his name. He was my language arts teacher. And that I thought about him yesterday when I was thinking about Jesus being a great teacher. I thought about Mr. Altizer. I hadn't thought about him in a long time, but I think of him from time to time because he was a fitness buff. And he was always, you'd always see him on the streets in Richlands, Virginia, where I grew up, just running, jogging and running all the time. And he had a massive heart attack in his 40s, and it killed him. I always appreciated him. He was a great teacher. The earliest memories that I have of getting up in front of a group of people and speaking was in Mr. Altizer's class. We would have to write stories and things, and then we'd get up and read our stories before the class. And you know, I'd get up, I'd start off nervous, but get into that, and then before you know it, we'd all be laughing and having a good time. And some of the fondest memories I have of that time period in my life was in Mr. Altizer's class. He was a good teacher. Amen. But you know, we need good teachers in biblical things today. We need good teachers to teach us this Bible. We need teachers that'll teach us sound doctrine, the things, the truths of the Word of God. That's very needful today. And Titus chapter 2 has something to say to that. And if you would like to follow along with us this morning, I want to read Titus chapter 2, beginning here in verse number 1. Here's what the Bible says. "But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. Not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. That they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men likewise." Now as I read this, I want you all to think about these verses and think about which one of these categories you belong into. Amen. Young men. So what we've got, so far we've got the aged women. We've got The young men here in verse number 6, before we finish it, we're going to get young women, old women, young men, older men, and servants. So think about which one of these categories you belong into. Verse 6, young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works in doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. Exhort servants to be obedient unto their own masters, and to please them well in all things, not answering again, not purloining, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God our Savior in all things. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee.
Yeah.
Correctly read, that's Titus chapter number 2. May God bless the reading of his word. This morning, we thank you for your good attention today. We probably won't be before you very long this morning. But I want to tell you today that everybody needs a good teacher. We need to be taught sound doctrine. We need to be taught the things of God. And the Apostle Paul in here writing to Titus covers it all. He covers the older women, the younger women, the older men, the younger men, and he covers servants. Amen. Now, servants, sometimes in the Bible, it refers to what we might call slaves. But it's not like slaves that we are familiar with in this country back in the 1800s when slavery was abounding in this world. We know that that is a sin. God does not condone that in the Bible. But the very fact that the Apostle Paul mentioned servants or slaves in his writings is not condoning the practice of slavery, but it's because by the grace of God, in God's Word, Paul, under the inspiration of the Spirit of God, is acknowledging a group of people who, according to many, weren't even people at all.
Yeah.
So it's an act of great grace that this is mentioned here in the Word of God. So we've got these five groups of people. But what is sound doctrine? I want you to think about that today, because doctrine is everywhere. And I find it very sad many times that when the word doctrine is mentioned in the context of church or faith, that sometimes it seems like it has a negative connotation to it, but I want you to know doctrine is a good thing. The doctrine of God as taught in the Bible, because everybody out there is preaching some kind of doctrine.
Yeah.
You don't have to come to church to hear doctrine.
Right.
Doctrine is being taught everywhere, and doctrine matters. They're all preaching it. Amen. Your family of origin that you grew up in, your mother, your father, your grandparents, whether they were saved or lost or knew anything about God or not, they were teaching you some kind of doctrine. And sometimes that doctrine that comes from our family of origin will be deeply ingrained in our person. It'll be deeply ingrained down in our heart as to who we are.
That's right.
Amen.
Schools are teaching doctrine. We've got marketing experts today that are spending billions and billions of dollars, and they're preaching doctrine to you.
Amen.
They're trying to shape you and mold you and to shape your way of thinking and to shape what you do, how you think, and who you are.
Yeah.
You can't ride down the interstate today without seeing some big billboard sign that somebody paid thousands of dollars to place an advertisement up there to try to sway your opinion one way or another. It's doctrine coming at you.
All right, man. All right.
But here in the Word of God, Paul says, "But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine." Doctrine matters. Every area of our lives today is influenced by some form of doctrine or another that's floating around out there. We've got voices coming to us on a day-to-day basis, time and time again. Which voices are you listening to? because there's a lot of voices out there that are clamoring for your attention today, but we need to be dialed into the voice of the Good Shepherd.
Amen.
Yeah. We need to be dialed in to the voice of the one who said, I am the Good Shepherd.
Amen.
I am the door. Amen.
Amen.
By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. But if a man climbs up some other way, he's the same as a thief and a robber. We need to be dialed in to the voice of the one today who said, my sheep know my voice, and a stranger they will not follow.
Amen.
But we've got a lot of voices
Amen. Coming
to us today, and they're all preaching doctrine. This is why we need to hold tightly to the doctrine of God, as mentioned in this Bible here, but speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. You know, there's a lot of doctrines out there that are floating around, and one thing in particular that we hear a lot about today is money. You know, there is a perspective, there is a worldly perspective of money. Then you've got whatever doctrine that your family of origin taught you about money. And then we have what the doctrine of God says about money.
Right.
You know what the world says about money? It says, well, you ought to just hoard it up and grab as much of it as you can, as quick as you can. The world says, why, you ought to take as much money as you can get and hoard that up and consume that upon your own lust and try to be as rich and prosperous financially as you can so you can indulge your greed.
Yeah.
So you can be stingy.
Yeah.
So you can be greedy. Yeah. So you can have everything that you feast your eyes on.
There you go.
Yeah.
In life.
Yeah.
That's the world's doctrine of money. You know, your family may have taught you a doctrine about money that might be a little bit different than that. I know growing up in Richlands, Virginia, my dad was a coal miner for many, many years, about 30 years. He mined. He'd come home every day just as black as the ace of spades. He was a hardworking man. We didn't have a lot of things, but I had everything I needed. Amen?
Yeah.
So he would come home after a hard day's work, and I learned by watching him that money was something that we needed to pay our bills, to live, to get by from one day to the next. And that's the doctrine that I was taught in my family. It wasn't all about, hey, let's go out here and be greedy and rake up as much as we can, and let's all be rich and let's all be millionaires and everything else. But then we have the doctrine that the Bible teaches about money, and it says you ought to be generous.
Yeah.
You ought to be a cheerful giver.
Yeah.
You ought to give out of your heart, as a necessity to those who are needy and less fortunate than we are.
Amen.
We ought to be generous.
Amen.
Generous givers. Yeah. For the Lord loves a generous giver, a cheerful giver.
Amen.
So there's many other areas that we could apply this to this morning, but you know, we are responsible for which doctrine we follow.
That's right.
We are responsible for which doctrine we let shape our lives and to shape our hearts and to mold us and to make us into the people that we are today. We are responsible for that. We are responsible for having our mind and soul formed by the teaching of the Word of God. If you want to be a follower of Jesus Christ, you've got to get somewhere in a community where the Word of God is being taught in truth and sincerity and in power and in demonstration of the Holy Ghost. Because we're responsible to God.
Amen.
Amen. You know, biblical illiteracy is an epidemic today in this world.
Yes.
But we don't have to be illiterate when it comes to the Bible.
That's right.
You can make the decision when you get up on a Sunday morning that I'm going to be found faithful in a Bible-believing, Bible-preaching church, just like the New Testament commands that we do so. Or you can make the decision to be illiterate and be ignorant and to stay out and to go somewhere else, go down to the flea market or whatever. The choice is yours.
Amen.
But we're responsible for that. If you want to grow and you want to learn more about God and you want to learn more about the doctrine of God in your life, I'm telling you right now, child of God, one way to do that is to get into a community, a church, where the Word of God is taught and it's taught correctly.
Yes.
Let me go back to these five groups that we mentioned. Because the Apostle Paul, when writing this letter to Titus, He evidently thought it was very important to target teach these specific groups. He says the aged women, likewise. Let me start back here with the aged men. Older men, this is what the Bible says you ought to do. You ought to be sober, grave, temperate, sound in the faith. Amen. We need our older men to be sound in the faith. Amen. If you've been saved for 30 or 40 years, you don't need to be acting like a new convert.
That's right.
You need to be somebody who's rooted, established, sound in the faith, sober-minded, level-headed, in charity and in patience. Older men, that's what you need to do. The aged women, this is for you. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness.
Yeah, right.
Older women, you need to be holy. You need to watch your behavior. You don't need to be false accusers. Not giving them much wine. Teachers of good things. And listen to verse 4. That they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, and to love their children. If you're an older woman who's a Christian this morning, you need to be teaching the younger women to do these things. But I see a problem today. A lot of our older women don't know how to do it themselves. But you see, we've got a standard here that we need to try to adhere to. These things are in the Bible for a reason. And we'll be blessed if we take these to heart.
Yes.
To be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, to be obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men, if you're in the category of young men, it says, likewise, exhort to be sober-minded, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works, in doctrine, showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned, that he that is of the contrary part may be ashamed, having no evil thing to say of you. So basically, young men, I would just sum that up by saying you need to be level-headed. You need to be sober-minded. You need to have a good head on your shoulders and not be out here floating with the whims of the world, unstable, double-minded in all your ways. The Bible has something to say about that. Amen?
Yeah.
Don't be tossed about with every wind of doctrine. You need to get level-headed, sober-minded, get your mind focused on God, and stay that way. Younger men, that's for you. Servants, it says, exhort servants to be obedient unto their own masters, and to please them well in all things, not answering again, not purloining, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. I believe that a lot of times servants, when it's mentioned here, like it is in this verse, refers to what we would refer to as indentured servants, somebody who's a hired hand, almost like a member of the family in some cases. It's not always talking about some harsh form of slavery like we are familiar with in this nation that took place here. But, you know, if you're a servant today, these verses will help you to be the Christian that God would have you to be.
Yeah.
I always appreciate it when I go out on a job somewhere. I do construction work part-time. Here lately it seems like it's been much more full-time, but I'm about to put an end to that. But I go out on these jobs, and it's a blessing to me to see people who proclaim to be Christians who actually do their bosses right. And they're not out there trying to hook them and crook them and stretch out their breaks and take 30-minute breaks when they're only supposed to be taking 15-minute breaks. You know, leaving an hour early and saying I left at 3:30 when you left at 2:30 and getting there 30 minutes late and saying, well, I got there at 7 o'clock. And always trying to beat somebody out of a dime. You know, that is not becoming of a child of God. If you're a child of God, you ought to be honest. You ought to work and labor as unto the Lord Himself. Amen. Christian people ought to be the best workers they are out there. They ought to be the best servants they are out there. They ought to be honest. They ought to be men of good report. They ought to be people of integrity.
Amen.
If you bear the name of Jesus Christ, you ought to be somebody of integrity.
Amen.
You see.
Right. Come on.
So we see.
Praise God.
Paul talks about the coming of Christ. Verse number 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men. Appeared, that's the Greek word epiphany, epiphania, where we get our word epiphany from. And it's mentioned again here in verse number 13 when it says, looking for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. It's talking about a divine revealing. Amen. Paul wrote about the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he wrote about the second coming. The first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, he came in grace. Amen. Some people rejected him. Some people still reject him today.
Yes.
But he's going to come back again, and everybody's going to know it.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's going to know who he is.
Amen.
And I'm thankful today to know that those of us who are saved by God's grace, when he comes back, Bible says the dead in Christ are going to rise first,
yes.
And we which are alive and remain shall come together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort ye one another with these words. I'm glad to know we've got a better place to go to.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
We've got a better place to go to. Paul's told us about it here in the Word of God. And I think this morning that it would be good. And we're going to bring this message to a close. I told you I'd be brief today. That if we would just come around, we're going to open up this altar here in just a moment for anyone who would like to come around. And I just want to thank the Lord for His coming. I want to thank the Lord for His first coming when He came and He went to that cross and He hung and bled and died and He gave His life that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. I want to thank Him for coming the first time.
Right.
But I want to thank Him for His second coming. I want to thank Him for the day when He comes back.
Amen.
And we leave this world.
Yeah.
And we're going to a better place.
Amen.
Amen. So Jesus, He was a good teacher. He taught sound doctrine. He wasn't just a good teacher. He was the best teacher there's ever been.
Amen.
Amen. And I want to honor Him this morning. And I believe that one way that we can honor Him, as Donna, if you'll come to the piano, one way that we can honor the Lord, we're going to give you an invitation now, is for you to become devoted, committed, and dedicated to being a disciple, to being a student of the Lord Jesus Christ. Become committed, devoted, and dedicated to learning His Word, learning His teachings, learning the things that He has left us in this Bible, and give our lives just to follow Him. Because that's how you honor a good teacher. You follow what they taught. You honor that with your life. And I wonder this morning, maybe there'd be somebody here today, and through this brief message here today, we've had a good service. I've not been preaching very long this morning, but it's been a good service. And if God has spoken to your heart, not because of me, but because of this Word and the Spirit of God speaking to your heart, and maybe the Lord has shown you that you've not been as devoted or a committed follower of Christ and His teaching as you should be, we want to give you an opportunity to come and repent and lay that down and dedicate your life to following Jesus. Maybe you're here this morning and you've been dedicated. You've been committed. You've been following the Lord just as good as you possibly can by His grace. And you want to come and thank Him for His promises that He's given us in this Word. Why, you can come this morning. And if you're here and you're lost, you've never been saved, and God, the Holy Ghost, has spoken to your heart today and has shown you that you need to repent and believe the gospel for the first time and become a child of God and be born again and saved by the grace of God, if that's you, well, I want to give you an invitation, dear friend, to come and lay your burdens down and give your life to Jesus. So whatever your need is now, this altar is open for whosoever would like to come and talk to God. God bless these coming already. God bless you. Lord, we thank you. We praise you, God, as these come this morning. Lord, your will be done. Speak to hearts, God, I pray. Lord, we know that that if anything of any spiritual benefit or lasting good happens here this morning, it'll be because of you. Lord, it couldn't possibly be because of anyone else except you. But Lord, as I look and this altar is filled up this morning, Lord, I'm just thankful, God, to know that you're in control. Lord, when it seems like we're at our weakest, that's when you're at your strongest. Your grace is sufficient, dear God. We love you. We thank you. And maybe some others would like to come around. We've still got room around the altar this morning. If you'd like to come, you just mind the Lord. We're going to pray with these folks. And I'm going to step back and let the Spirit of God continue to take control of this service.